Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? I am. I love coming to church. Amen. We're going to do a new six-week series called The Revelation of Tithing, Restoring the Lost Message of Finances in its Proper Perspective. But before we do that, I want to start with a little joke. There were these two guys who got stranded on this deserted island. And one of them was frantic, and he was running back and forth, just fearing for his life. And the other guy was just sitting in the sun, enjoying the beach. And the guy who was frantic looks at his friend and says, "Aren't you worried that we're about to die?" And he says, "No. I make $100,000 a week, and I tithe faithfully. My pastor will find me." Boy, there's a lot of truth to that. We're going to talk about giving for the next few weeks. Why? In fact, let me get this. I have, forgive me, guys. Let me download. I got to download my message. I thought I had it on here. I did, but I accidentally got rid of it or something. Here we go. There we go. God is good. Amen. We're going to talk about giving for the next few weeks. And why are we going to do that? It's really interesting because since the founding of Radiant Life Church, did you know I've only did a series on giving one time? 2016. And one of the reasons why I've only done it once is because a lot of times people think that's all pastors want to talk about. Yet in this church in 15 years, I've only done one series on giving. And it's in 2016. And you may be saying, well, why now? Well, with the high cost of food, gas, and other living expenses, let the church say amen. Many families are having a difficult time making ends meet, and I'm speaking financially. So the purpose of this series, because I've been praying, I said, Lord, what do you want me to do about this? Because I hear you. The Lord said, I want you to teach them on how to receive supernatural breakthroughs, because the way you receive spiritual breakthroughs financially is when you follow the principles found in the Word of God. And so I want you to see this as not as a time of dread. I want you to see it as a time that I'm going to put into your hand the principles so that no matter what happens, that you're ready for it and that you are supernaturally covered in this time of high inflation. Amen. And I don't have to go way back in the dark ages to give you an example. I live by this. Just a few weeks ago, I needed a financial breakthrough. So I don't know if you remember, some of you might remember, we decided to have an offering for our lead deacons, Mark and Lisa Pena, who were having a financial need. Now, why did I decide to do that? Because I personally needed a breakthrough. And I've learned the power of giving. And many of you saw, opened up my wallet, and I gave all that I had. And it truly was all that I had. And God did a miracle, did great things for me. But in the second service, we decided to give it to Jim, who was just here just a minute ago. Jim, wherever you are, I know I saw you. But Jim, for all practical purposes, is homeless, but he doesn't miss church. He rides his bike. He does not miss church. And so we had an offering for Jim, and he was standing up there, and I saw Jim, and I saw that he took his money that he was receiving from you all that were here, and he gave a tithe off of it. And I was like, proud of him. I was like, wow, that's beautiful. I saw what he did. The following week, he comes up to me, he goes, Pastor, you're a man of God. And I go, I know, but why are you telling me that? And he says, I didn't have more than $100 to my name last week. And then he lifts up and he shows me his phone, and God blessed him with $3,000 that week. How many know that if God can do it for Jim, he can do it for you? Without having a job or having the things, but God blessed him. And so the first teaching might sound like a rebuke, but it's not. It's to give you revelation knowledge. And then the next five, we're going to be moving in principles, but we have to start somewhere. Amen. So let's start with Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 44. There are three areas of giving that God has given to the church to supply its needs. And these terms are not synonyms, and they're not interchangeable. Often people will mix these terms, but they are not the same. Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 44 says, And at that time, there were some appointed over the chambers for the treasures, for the offerings, for the first fruits, and for the tithes, to gather into them out of the fields of the cities the portions of the law for the priests and Levites. And Judah rejoiced for the priests and for the Levites that waited. I want you to notice that it says there are three forms of giving. You have tithes, you have offerings, you have first fruits. Now, why are they listed? Because they're not the same thing. And so what I want to do briefly is give you a brief definition of them. In fact, when we do our tithes and offering every week, even the language that we use in our announcements was birthed out of the series I did in 2016. So I'm going to stick with that language. For example, let's do the tithe. What is a tithe? I'm going to give a brief overview. A tithe is 10% of the gross income, and it goes to the local church. Put in your notes Leviticus 27:30, because I can't read all the scriptures, because there's many of them. Now, interesting thing about the tithe you need to understand is that you don't decide the percentage, and you don't decide how it's spent. You have no say in that. You can't say, well, you know, this week I'm going to tithe 2%. That's not tithing. The word tithe means 10%. You don't decide the percentage. You don't decide where it's spent. It also, another rule of the tithe, and you'll see this as we look at the scriptures, is that it has to be given to the local church. You can't take a tithe and, you know what, this brother over here is hurting. I'm going to take my tithe and I'm going to give it to somebody. You can't do that. That's unscriptural. Well, you can do that, but there's another name for it. It's the next word. It's called an offering. A tithe is not an offering. Offering is not a tithe. So what is an offering? It's the amount you give to the Lord above your tithe for any special spiritual need in the church. That's found in Romans chapter 15, verse 25 through 27. And here's another thing. You can't give your offering until you've given a tithe. What do I mean by that? A lot of times, people will give an offering and say, here's an offering for the church. But in reality, if you did not pay your tithes, you're just paying a delinquent tithe. Come on. I'm explaining this so you understand this. You cannot pay an offering until you paid your tithe. If I make $200 a week, my tithe would be $20. That would be my tithe. And if there's a need, I can't give that for that need. I can give an offering. And if I give $5, my total giving was $25. $20 was my tithe, $5 was my offering. Do you understand that? Really important that we're on the same page. Now, the amount given in regards to a tithe, you get to choose that amount. Also, this is where you actually get to say who it goes to. The tithe, you can't give your tithes and tell the pastor, this is what you're going to do with it. That is unbiblical. It's actually obnoxious. But when you give an offering, you do decide how much and where does it go. That is your choice. An offering, you have a lot to say. Tithe, you have nothing to say other than we're commanded to give it to our local church. First fruits. We're just looking at an overview. And I'm going to slow down a little bit with first fruits because I never get the time to really talk about this, but this is powerful. First fruits, it is the planned portion from your first financial income received after the new year that you give in dedication to God. Let me repeat that again. It's found in Numbers chapter 18, verse 12 through 13. The first financial income that you receive, no matter how you receive it, you pick a portion of that and you give that as a representative of the rest. And that's what we call first fruits. Now, maybe your first check, your first day's pay, or your first hourly pay. And we're told to give first fruits out of every income generating thing that you have, or I like to say it this way, out of every income generating enterprise. What do I mean by that? If I work at, you know, a place where I'm a mailman, I get a paycheck, I can give my first fruits from that, but then say I have an online business too, well, I would give my first fruits from that. So anywhere where you have a income generating, we're supposed to give first fruits from every one of those. Has nothing to do with tithe, it has nothing to do with offering. Whatever that first income comes in, we give that to God as a first fruits. And now you may be saying, well, why would I do that? Well, this is where it gets really good. And I want you to write this down, or at least memorize this. First fruits produces likeness. Say that. First fruits produces likeness. It's the only type of giving where you produce likeness. Now, this is where I need to just break this down for a second. It's powerful. On the Festival Day of First Fruits, it was one of the seven festivals that the children of Israel were commanded to celebrate. On the day of First Fruits, the nation of Israel would come together and they would bring him the best representative of their oil, their wine, their wheat, our produce that had burst out of the ground, even the firstborn of their livestock. Whatever their income was, they would bring that first part that came out of the ground. And why did they pick the best representative? Why would they pick? Because if you had apples, you'd go to your orchard and here at that tree, it's the first day where you can reap. You, before you would do anything, you would get a best representative of that and you'd bring that to the house of the Lord and you'd pick the best representative. Why? Because first fruits produces likeness. When you would bring your first fruits to the Lord, you were basically making a dedication prayer. You're saying, Lord, let the rest of my year, let the rest of my harvest look like this one. Come on. So you would never bring, you know what? There's a bunch of apples. I got to bring my first. This one's the smallest. It's the nastiest. There's worms. I'm going to give that to God. You would never do that. Because if you did, what you're saying, God, let me have the rest of my harvest look like that. Come on. Because it produces what? Likeness. So you would get the, and you did that with your oil. You did that with whatever income you had. That's what you would do. You would give your best example of that. Now, here's where it applies to you today. Before the world even began, God wanted sons. And in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5, you can write that down. It says, even before the predestination of the world, that God wanted sons. So you need to understand this. In order for God to receive a son, he had to sow a son. Because you reap what you what? No wonder why in John 3:16, we all know it. For God so loved the world. And what did he want? According to Ephesians 1:5, he wanted sons. When I say sons, I'm not just talking about males. I'm talking about male and female. Generic sons, right? Children. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten what? Now, why? Because he had to sow a son to reap a son. In John chapter 12, verse 24, it's interesting because the Greeks wanted to see Jesus. He hadn't gone to the cross yet. They literally traveled like the people from the Far East to see Jesus. But this is at the end of the ministry. And they go, we want to see Jesus. And he goes, you can't see me. And he tells them why. Look at this, John 12, 24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much what? Fruit. He basically says, I can't see you. And the reason why I can't see you is because God wants sons. And in order for you to come, I have to go into the ground. He has, because I'm the best representative of a man. He wanted a son, so he picked the best representative. And he says, before I can see you, I got to go in the ground so that when I come out of the ground, it will bear much fruit. You'll be able to come with me. Come on. That's why 1 John 3:2, look what this says. This is powerful. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, even though it does not yet appear. Stop right there. Did you know that right now you're a son of God? And you go, it sure don't look like it. I know the Bible says it. Sometimes we don't always act the way we should. Amen? It says it does not yet appear, but keep going. It says what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be just like him, for we shall see him for who he is. It says we're already the sons of God, but the full manifestation will be when we stand before him. And the reason why we're able to, because Christ went into the ground and everything that comes after him, every son will look just like him. Notice when God wanted a son, he didn't put Frankenstein in the ground. He didn't, oh, come here, I love Jesus. Come on. He didn't put the Phantom of the Opera in there. He didn't put some weird, come on. Who did he put? He put the what? Best representative, because he says, I want them all to look like Jesus. Amen? That is why Jesus, write this down, did you know that he literally rose again on the day of first fruits? It literally was the day when all the harvest comes out of the ground. That was the day he rose from the dead. That's why he's called the first fruits of them that rose from the dead. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20. And now is Christ risen from the dead and has become, what does it say? The first fruits of them that slept. In other words, God said, I wanted a son. I'm going to sow the best representation of a son, put him in the ground, and when he comes out, my harvest will be sons of God all over the place. So that is the spiritual relevance of first fruits. But the Bible says there is a financial relevance that just like God sowed his son, when you sow financially your first fruits at the beginning of the new year, you're going to reap what you've sown. Every person that has a revelation on what I just told you, every one of them prospers greatly here. They're all my top givers. In fact, one of my top givers, even here this morning, it was interesting. We had a meeting a few weeks ago. He goes, you know, Pastor, every year I do this and every year it works. He says, I bring my first fruits. Now, remember what first fruits is. It can be your first day's pay, your first hourly pay. It's the first of that income that comes in. Every year he would give that. But a few years ago, he started, you know what? Every year I'm going to give first fruits of what I want to be paid. Come on. And he said, again, Pastor, took about 3 months, but this year, he goes, did you notice your tithe went up? I said, yes, and I appreciate it. And he says, are your first fruits the first fruits I gave more than I go? I noticed that. And then he goes, I started giving what I wanted. And guess what? Within 3 months, he was getting it. Which means his tithing also went up because he literally began tithing after that, even before it came in. Did you hear what I just said? What is what I'm saying? Say this, first fruits produces likeness. So every year, and you only have one opportunity to begin the year where you can literally reap big time if you understand what I just told you. It's a law that God created. Now, that's just the introduction. In the Bible, we find Jesus observing people when they give. It's really peculiar. In fact, let's go to Luke 21, 1 through 4. And I want to make two observations about Jesus being, if you will, nosy about what people give. Let's watch this.
As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. Truly, I tell you, he said, this poor widow has put in more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on.
Now, most of you are familiar with the widow's two mites, and I don't want to go over what you already know. You already know that she gave more because she gave all that she had. But I want you to notice there are two observations when you look at this. That's why I found a video so you could see it. The first observation is I want you to notice that Jesus observed what they gave. And you have a lot of people go, oh, giving ain't all that important. God don't care. If it wasn't all that important, then why did Jesus waste his time watching people give in the temple? People are, well, God really don't care. If he don't care, why would he write that in the scripture? Why would it tell you he's sitting in the temple watching people give? By the way, I think he's still doing that. He cares. And let me tell you why. Because where you spend your money, it reflects the attitude of your heart. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 2, it says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be what? Also. You know what that means? Wherever you spend your money, that's what you really value. Guess what? If you were to look at my bank account, you'll see I spent a lot of money on someone named Bridget Kern. In fact, just the other day, I went to the store and my dad was with me and I saw these beautiful flowers and they weren't cheap. And you know what? It wasn't Mother's Day. It wasn't, why did I do it? Because I value that girl. And I bought those flowers and I came home and I gave them to her and to see that face. And it doesn't bother that I may not be able to go to lunch the next day because I did that because I value her. Come on. And you'll know what you value. Go look at your bank statements. You'll know what I value. I really value going out to eat. I eat out a lot. But it's not the eating out. It's who I go out with. And you'll also see a lot of statements to Radiant Life Church because I love Radiant. Where you spend your money. In fact, you don't even have to know someone. Just look at their bank accounts and you'll know what they're into. Sometimes that ain't always good. Come on. But that's why Jesus is looking. He's like, who's giving and how much they're giving? Because how much they give tells you how much they value. Secondly, he didn't just observe what they gave. Did you notice he observed how they gave it? How you give is just as important as how much you give. Look at Mark 12:41. And Jesus sat over against the treasury and he beheld, notice the words, how the people cast money. He looked at the way they did it. Jesus was watching how both the rich and the poor, how they gave in the temple treasury. Why? Because your attitude in giving is just as important as how much you give. So I have a question for you. Are you happy when you give? Are you like Oscar the Grouch on that point? Are your butt, you know, you're squeezing together the moment? Come on. How do you feel when tithe and offerings are taken? This is important. Because we are told, if we go to 2 Corinthians 9:6, how to give. It says, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap bountifully. First, the Lord shows you how to sow. He says, if you sow a little, don't be surprised if you get a little back from God. He says, if you sow big time, you're going to get what? So he tells you how to give. The next part he says what to give first. Then he says, now let me show you how to give. He says, every man according as he purposeth this in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly, nor out of necessity, for God loveth a what? A cheerful giver. So the Bible says we're not to give grudgingly. You know what that means? It means reluctantly, unwillingly, resentfully. You ever give to God and you go, man, I wish I wouldn't have done that. You're not supposed to give that way. We're not supposed to give out of necessity. The Greek word is out of grief, sorrow, pain. Some people literally almost about to die every time they give something. Some people are so cheap that it almost kills them. They experience, you know, death when they give. And the Bible says, God says, I'm not going to bless that. He says, for God loveth the what? Say it again. For God loveth the what? In the Greek, are you ready for this? It's the word hilaros. Say hilaros. It's where we get the word hilarious. So God loves a what? A hilarious giver. What does that mean? That you're so joyful when you give that it makes God smile. When you give, are you like this? Are you like full of smile? Because God does care. And you made me think, oh, Joseph, you're making a big deal. No, I'm not. Because if you're a parent, you understand this. When your kids come, you'll give them anything. But doesn't it frustrate you when you gave them their food, they gave them everything they want, and they're still crying? There's something about being ungrateful. In fact, if you're me, I've done this. If you don't be quiet, I'm going to take it all away from you right now. Because I want you to smile when I give you something. I want you to be happy. Come on. So even as a parent, you should understand that when you do something for your children, you want to be happy. When God's blessing you all week long, and you're giving that, and you're kind of angry, he's like, hey, you know, you're being kind of ungrateful here. Amen to myself. Praise the Lord. So what is a tithe? You know, before I say that, I want to say this. The what and how you give reflects the desire, the conviction, the passion, and the attitude of your heart. And there's also another thought that I wrote down here that I want to give you, and I almost missed it. When you do give your tithes, your offering, and your first fruit, the first question you should ask is, what do I want the rest of my harvest to look like? Because how you give is how you're going to what? The way you sow is the way you're going to what? Reap. So what is a tithe? Let's go to Leviticus 27, 30 to 32. Now I'm going to slow down and we're going to look at this. Let's hear this.
And all the tithe of the land, whether of the seed of the land or of the fruit of the tree, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. If a man wants at all to redeem any of his tithes, he shall add 1/5 to it. And concerning the tithe of the herd or the flock, of whatever passes under the rod, the 10th one shall be holy to the Lord.
The word tithe there is the word tenth. It's the Hebrew word maser. Say maser. It literally means tenth. A tithe or tenth of all increase, that's what the scripture says, of all increase is to be given to the Lord. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 22. Thou shalt truly tithe all the increase of thy seed. Let's stop right there. We can stop right there. It's interesting that whenever the Bible talks about tithing, it always says, thou shalt what? Truly tithe. You know why? A lot of people don't truly tithe. But the Bible, I want you to notice, every time we go to scripture, God will say to truly tithe. Why? Because a lot of people don't tithe, they tip. If you gave $100 in the offering, that means you only made $1,000 this month? Come on. If you, right? That's called tipping. That's not tithing. And so the Bible constantly says, make sure you truly tithe. Don't just put any number in there. Make sure you know that you're truly tithing. This is really important. Amen? It says that thou shalt truly tithe all the increase of thy seed that the field bringeth forth year by year. The word increase is the Hebrew word tabua. It literally means revenue. In other words, we're to give a tenth of all of our revenue, all of our profit, our positive cash flow, etc. to God. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 14. But for time's sake, I'm not going to read the whole thing because it would take about 3 minutes. I actually timed it. So let me just read a portion of it. If we go to verse 22, it says, notice, here's a different scripture. Thou shalt, what does it say? What? Thou shalt what? Why does God every time mention tithe and he says truly? I think he understands that there's a problem with a lot of people who don't truly tithe. There's a lot of lying tithing. Some of you will get that in a minute. But the Bible says to truly tithe. In other words, whatever you get, truly tithe 10%. All the increase of thy seed that the field bringeth forth year by year. Go to verse 23. The tithe of the corn, of the wine, of the oil, the first fruits of thy herd and thy flocks. And it says that thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God always. Go to verse 25. Then shalt thou turn it into money and shall bind up the money into thine hand and shall go into the place which the Lord thy God shall choose. In biblical days, it was mainly an agricultural setting. Therefore, they gave a tenth of all their crops and their animals. But the system we use today is a monetary cash flow system. Therefore, we bring a tenth of our paychecks to the house of the Lord. And some people, and you know, we're going to cover a lot. We got 6 weeks. Is that some people go, tithing ain't for today because they gave of their agriculture. Okay, that's because that was the system they used. But if you paid attention, you notice that in the middle of the verse, it says, if you were far from Jerusalem where the temple was, you had to take those cows, that oil, that wheat, and you had to convert it to cash, and you had to bring it to the house of the Lord. So that does away with they didn't give money. That's not true at all. They were commanded. Remember, back then, this was wealth. Cattle was wealth. So they gave it to the priest. They could easily turn around and cash it in. But if you lived too far, you had to do it yourself. You had to cash it in and bring in the monetary value to the temple of the Lord. Now, there are two ways to calculate the tithe. And I want to do this because it sounds so simple, but some people don't understand it. One way is that you take whatever amount you make, okay, and you multiply it by 10%. You do that by converting it into a decimal point. But let me tell you, it's a lot easier if you just do this. Just write the amount that you made that week, that month, and just bring over the decimal point over one, and you have your tithe. So let's look at this. If someone makes $2,560.84, all you do is you bring over the decimal point over, right, to the left over here. And when you do that, how much do you owe as a tithe? $256.08. If you made, and I would love for you to do this, if you made $10,420.64, guess what? You just bring over the decimal point over to the left, and how much do we, come on, let's say it together, how much do we owe the Lord? Great class. Now watch, if you made $525.65, that was what you made for the month, you bring the decimal point over to the left, how much, class, come on, help me, how much do we owe the Lord? You want me to tell you something? That's about the average tithe I see in this church. So I'm like, how do you live off $525? The truth is, no one is. That's because we're doing what the Bible says, thou shalt truly tithe. Amen? So a lot of people are tipping the Lord. They're not tithing. What you should call it is a tip. And I said it earlier, you're going to get tipped over if you keep on doing that. So watch, and the moment people get the revelation of tithing, that's when these questions come in. Do I tithe off the net or the gross? Right? Before taxes or after taxes? Well, the scripture does tell us what to do. In verse 22, it says to pay a tithe off of all increase, which would mean the gross. Why? Because even your tax money goes towards increase, your increase in an army, in police, streets, sewer systems that you reap the benefit, water that comes, that's where your taxes go. So that's increase. That's why we tithe off of the gross. Now, here's a scripture. I've never heard anyone tell me they memorized it. Ready? It's probably the most unpopular scripture. Go to Leviticus 27:31. And if a man will if a man will all redeem aught of his tithes, he shall add thereto the fifth part thereof. If you go, I'm not going to pay my tithes this week, I'm going to pay it next month, God says, you owe me 20% now. You just hear what I said? Oh, it's getting quieter in this place. The Lord charges interest. If you don't pay tithes, now here's what's crazy. We all know this is self-accountability. I'm never going to come to you and say, hey, you know what? You didn't pay your tithes this week. You owe 20%. But I wonder how many things in the spirit realm are going wrong because we're ignorant of this. And financially, God, if you were to speak to me and say, you owe me more than that tithe, you fix that and I'll fix everything else. The reason why we don't know, well, you should have never told me I'm ignorant. No, if you're ignorant, you're going to suffer a curse anyways. It's better to know that you pay your tithes in time. You're saying, Pastor, why is this so important? Let me tell you why. I'll get people once in a while come to me and say, Pastor, I'm having a hard time. Can I pay my tithes 6 months from now? And I'm like, well, can you wait 6 months to pay your bills? The SRP, they don't care that I'm a church. They're not going to say, yes, Joseph, you're such a wonderful guy. 6 months from now, we'll charge you. The guy who owns this place, you know, I pay him $12,000. You know what? I feel sorry for that person. We're going to wait for them to pay their tithes, and you can pay us in 6 months. Come on. They don't care. It's not different from a church. You pay your tithes. It has to be on time. If you don't, you owe God 20%. I'm never going to come before you and ask you for 20%, but I'm just telling you, these are rules that God made in the spirit realm, and if you break them, some people, their breakthrough is literally to stop being cheap with God. That's heavy stuff right there. It's really good stuff. You know, and another thing, it's, maybe I should do this. When people say, Pastor, can I put off 2 months? I'm just going to say, yeah, let's sign a contract. You owe 20% in that second month. Oh, man, I'll do that all day long. Okay. Anyways. So why do we pay our tithes? Why do we pay our tithes? Now, I already know many of you are internet scholars, YouTube scholars. You'll go find someone you agree with, and they are teaching the most off things. One of the things that we will cover probably next week is because you get these people saying, we're not supposed to tithe anymore. It's a New Testament. That is the worst lie you've ever been told. In fact, we'll get to the New Testament scriptures on tithing and we'll explain that. And it's going to blow your mind when you understand because the enemy wants to rob you. So we'll get to that, but I can't teach it all in one day. But why do we tithe? There's three reasons according to the scripture. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23. It tells us the first reason. It says that thou mayest learn to fear the Lord thy God always. Not sometimes, what? Always. The first reason why God tells us to pay tithes, it says it teaches us to learn to fear him. It literally means to be obedient. It teaches us obedience. The word learn is the Hebrew word lamad. It means instructing. The word fear is the word yare, it means reverencing. The word always comes from the Hebrew word kalah, it means to be complete or perfect, or perfected. So in other words, the Lord established tithing because it teaches us how to live in a constant or consistent state of reverence, our faith, which is manifested in our obedience to his word in regards to tithing. In other words, there's no better way to test whether you truly love God than with your money. Think about it. Anyone in this room can say, I love God, and I can't deny it. I don't know. I can't read your heart. Anybody can say, I love the Lord. But there is one way you can prove it. Show me your checkbook. Because your checkbook will really show you, whoa, this person does love the Lord. My wife, if I never spent any money on her, wasn't paying bills, why is she there? In fact, I can tell you, she won't be. Because she wants to see proof. It's not enough for me to make love to her. Come on. When you just make love to a woman and she gets no benefit, that's called whoredom or prostitution. Well, even the prostitute gets something. Come on. Are you hearing what I'm saying? There should be something that demonstrates, and think about it, there's no better way to demonstrate your love for God. And he says, it will teach you always, every month, it's a reminder, how much do you love me? Are you going to walk by faith? Are you going to walk by fear? Are you going to believe I can provide? Are you going to believe that I can provide? It literally is a constant test between, for me and you, with God. Am I going to believe God this week? Amen. Right? There are a lot of people talking, show me your money. Right? Show me the money. Jerry Maguire, right? God's saying that, show me the money. You love me? Show me the money. So the first reason, God literally chose a way to prove that our walk matches our talk. That we can say we love him, but we can prove it with our payments to the Lord, if you will, with our tithing. Reason number two, why do we tithe? This is so fascinating. The scripture says, so that there will be meat in my house. Say that, so that there will be meat in my house. This is amazing scripture. Go to Malachi 3, 8 through 10. And so he says, you need to tithe so that there can be meat in my house. Let's hear this.
Will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And try me now in this, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven, and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it.
This is such an important message to God that we cannot not observe the words he chooses to use here. He says, you and the whole nation has robbed me. How have we robbed you? You're in heaven. He says, you robbed me from my tithes and my offerings. Now, I want you to notice, he did not say, or call the people a thief. He didn't say, you're a thief. He said, you're a robber. Now, why? That language is really harsh. It's strong because a thief is non-confrontational. They don't want to confront you. They wait till you leave your house and then they break into your house because they don't want to confront you. They're kind people, okay? They don't want to hurt you. They just want what you got. So they're thieves. They steal it. A robber, he's confrontational. He gets a gun and right to your face. He says, give it to me right now. He'll abuse you. He'll beat you. He'll kill you because he doesn't care. He's straight up in your face. I'm going to rob you right here. And God says, you haven't been thieves. You've been a robber. You look at me right in my face, say, I'm not giving it. I don't care what you say. And you've robbed me. Those are really harsh words. And then God commands to bring the tithe to the storehouse. What is the storehouse? When you do a word study on the storehouse, it's clearly understood to be the local church. It's the place where God has called you to go. In fact, you can't take your tithe just anywhere. It tells you, you have to take it to the local storehouse, which is your local church. Notice even Deuteronomy 12, 11 in regard to the tithe. Then there shall be a place which the Lord your God shall choose. Look at Deuteronomy 12, 18. And in the place which the Lord thy God shall choose. These are all scriptures regarding the tithe. You don't get to pick where it goes. You go to wherever God has called you. If that's the local church you go to, that's where you give it. I'll never forget when I was going, I thought this was harsh, but when I was a young kid, the pastor, I knew him on a personal level. And one day a person said, Pastor, well, I give my tithes, this is a long time ago, I give my tithes to Benny Hinn. And you know what he said? He goes, okay, when you're in the hospital, don't call me, call Benny Hinn. I thought, wow, I understand that now. Benny Hinn ain't gonna take care of you. I give it to TBN back then. It was really big to give. Great, give your offerings, but you better pay your tithes here because Paul Crouch ain't gonna visit you. He's not gonna do your funeral. He's not, come on. No one realizes they need you until someone dies. Are they in the hospital? Are they messed up and their wife is gone? Come on. Deuteronomy 14, 23. And thou shalt eat before the Lord thy God, talking about the tithe, in the place where he shall choose. And over, it tells you where he chose, in the storehouse, at the church that you attend. And he tells you why. So Lord, Why do you want me to give my tithes and my offerings? He said, so, King James, so that there will be meat in my house. Come on, say there will be meat in my house. Say that. What, does God have a big locker of meat in there? No. The word meat over through the whole scripture from Genesis to Revelation is speaking of spiritual food, strong food. Let me give you an example. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2. It says, I have fed you with milk, Paul speaks, and not with meat. For hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither yet now are you able. So Paul, talking to the church at Corinth, says, I've been giving you milk. I want to give you revelation. I want to give you some meat, but you're not ready yet. Look at 1 Corinthians 10, 3. And they all did eat, this is speaking of the Old Testament, the same spiritual meat. Talking about the doctrine of Moses, that they ate spiritual meat when Moses taught them. Look at Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. For when the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk, and not of what? Strong meat. So here, the writer of Hebrews rebuking them. You guys should be ready for meat. But here I find myself teaching the beginning principles of God, baptism, the repentance from the dead, resurrection. He goes, we should move on from this. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 14, two verses later. But strong meat belongeth to them that are full age, even those by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. So when God says, you've robbed me, he says, how have we robbed you? By not paying your tithes and offering. Well, why do we pay him, Lord? So that there will be meat in my house. So that we can have strong spiritual teaching. It costs money. You know why you guys get filet mignon every week? Because you take good care of me. I don't work in the world anymore. I literally spend, 18 hours of my day pastoring people, going to hospital, visiting, studying, because you guys pay the bills. And therefore, you don't get some downloaded sermon from online. You don't get some type of, I'm going to rush it through. You can tell this takes time. Why do you get that? You get meat because you pay your tithes and your offerings. Come on. He said that. He said tithe so that there will be meat, but there's costs with that. A lot of places you go and the food is lousy. Come on. That's because that pastor has no time. Your average pastor has a church of 80 and he works 1 to 2 jobs. How's he supposed to get a sermon for you? Come on. Don't look at Joe Osteen and think everybody's like that. How many other Joe Osteens are there? There's not that many. This is why the Bible says to pay ministers well. Let's look at this. I'm so glad we're going to. Man, I haven't studied. We only did this one time, and I get to do it one more time in 20 years, okay? 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 17 through 18. Look what this says. Let the elders that rule be counted worthy of double honor. Highlight that word. Underline that. Especially those who labor in the word and doctrine. For the scripture saith, thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn, and the laborer is worthy of his reward. So notice when it speaks about your pastor, he says you should be giving him double honor. And then he says, and then he quotes a verse. He says, don't muzzle the ox. What does that mean? Go to the next slide. Muzzle the ox. The children of Israel, they had an agricultural setting. And it was the ox that would tread out the grain. And of course, while the ox is treading out the grain, it's getting hungry, so it eats some of the grain while it's working. And some people were so stingy, so selfish, they would muzzle the ox so that it couldn't eat any of the grain that they were treading out. And God said, that's evil. He actually wrote a commandment, thou shalt not muzzle the ox. That thing's a beast of burden that's providing for you. Why should it not eat some of when it's providing for you? Don't muzzle the ox. And so Paul uses that analogy. He says, why do you all want your pastor broke? Why do you want him to work hard, but you don't want to give him anything of significance in the natural of your finances? He says, don't muzzle the ox. There's a lot of oxes, pastors that have been muzzled. So the idea conveyed here is that a minister should be able to reap some of the financial income that is collected as the church labors, as while he labors in the word of, or she labors in the word of God. In fact, let's look at this. Let me show you another scripture. You know, before we do that, let me explain this. What is double honor? So it says, don't muzzle the ox. In other words, make sure that pastor's being taken care of and give them, notice the word say double honor. You know what double honor is? I'm glad you just asked. Say, what is it, pastor? Okay, now I got to tell you. Double honor is whatever the average pay of the congregation is, double honor would be times two. So if the average congregational person in your church makes $25,000, double honor would be what? 50. Rightfully so. Now, I don't do that. But according to the scripture, I have the right to do that if I chose. Does that make sense? That scripture, did I not give it to you? In fact, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 9 through 11. And notice, Paul again talks about this muzzling the ox. And let's hear this.
For it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle an ox while it treads out the grain. Is it oxen God is concerned about? Or does he say it altogether for our sakes? For our sakes, no doubt, this is written, that he who plows should plow in hope, and he who threshes in hope should be partaker of his hope. If we have sown spiritual things for you, is it a great thing if we reap your material things?
Paul's using some humor here. He says he's talking about the pay of a minister. Don't muzzle the ox. And then he goes, do you think this is written for the ox sake? He's telling God put these principles so you can understand it, how it applies to someone who sows the word. Amen. And what is the idea that Paul's communicating? He literally says, if we have sown into you spiritual things, is it a great thing that we shall reap your carnal things? In other words, the idea that the Apostle Paul is communicating is that true ministers, someone say true ministers, I mean called ministers of the gospel, those who labor faithfully to preach the gospel should be rewarded financially by their congregation. Now remember, why do we tithe? So that there will be meat in my house. If you don't have a good preacher, you won't have some good teaching, some good meat. And a lot of churches lack some meat. You go there and it's a lot of milk. Come on, I've been there, I've seen it. But he says, pay them well so that they give their life to it and they can bring, so there would be meat in my house. It would be a time of rejoicing. It'd be a time where you really learn something, not something that you can download yourself on the internet or YouTube. The real concern here about so that there would be meat in my house is that if the congregation doesn't pay their tithes, then ministers will not be able to function in the house of the Lord and serve the people the what? The word of God, meat in the house. I was confronted with this as a young minister at 18. And I, along with a lot of people, were financially abused by the church. I'll never forget, I was full-time ministering, yet I was so poor and broke. And I'll never forget when I read Nehemiah chapter 13. And when I read Nehemiah 3, I go, I didn't know this was in there. I go, how is it that churches talk about money every week? But to this day, I've never heard one preacher break down Nehemiah 13. And you know, Nehemiah 13, it was about the musician, people like me at that time. And I realized, whoa, wait, I'm supposed to be taken care of. I'm a musician in the house of the Lord. I'm a Levite. And I'll never forget the first time. I mean, I was crying because I was like, why am I struggling so bad? And God showed me the answer. First thing I did was call my best friend at the time, Eddie James, an international gospel artist. I said, Eddie, did you know that the Bible says they're supposed to be taking care of us? He goes, what? Where's that? And I showed him in the Bible. And man, we both started crying. I go, dude, we've been abused. We've been taken advantage of. And so what is Nehemiah 13? Nehemiah 13 is about Nehemiah. Remember God called him to rebuild the walls? And when he goes to Jerusalem, this is Jerusalem where the temple is, the house of the great God. He goes in there, and it was the sorriest service he ever attended. There was nobody in there but a fat preacher. There were no musicians. There was no one to greet you. The music, there was nothing. He's like, this is the sorriest service I ever been to. And he goes, where's the musicians? Where's the greeters? Where's the porters? Where? And he goes outside, and they're all working in the field. They had, just like you, they had to supply. So they couldn't work in the church because they had to earn their own income. And Nehemiah rebuked that pastor, that priest. And he rebuked the people for not tithing. and he rebuked them. And then he set certain Levites over so that they could be compensated. And he literally reestablished praise and worship. The services were jamming. They were exciting to go because they started tithing and people were held accountable. Listen to this. Let's hear it.
I also realized that the portions for the Levites had not been given them.
How do you realize
for
this?
Each of the Levites and the singers who did the work had gone back to his field. So I contended with the rulers and said, why is the house of God forsaken? And I gathered them together and set them in their place. Then all Judah brought the tithe of the grain and the new wine and the oil to the storehouse. And I appointed as treasurers over the storehouse Shelemiah the priest and Zadok the scribe, and of the Levites Pedaiah. And next to them was Hanan, the son of Zachar, the son of Mattaniah. For they were considered faithful, and their task was to distribute to their brethren. Remember me, O my God, concerning this, and do not wipe out my good deeds that I have done for the house of my God and for its services.
Of all the great things that Nehemiah did, he said, Lord, remember me for this, that I restored the house of God. It was fun to go to service and hear music and have laughter and joy because we restored the tithe. People will sometimes ask me, Pastor, why do we spend so much money on a band? Think of it. My wife's a great singer. I could get a soundtrack for $12. She could come up with singers and sing, save me $1,000. You know I could do that, right? You know why I don't? Because it's unscriptural. We're required, according to scripture, and no pastor will tell you this, a percentage is supposed to go to the Levites, the musicians. And we're still not even doing enough. Because according to the scripture, they should all be full-time. You know why they're not? Because I can only do what you give, but I'm not going to rob them. I'm going to do the best that I do have, and I'm going to give it to them. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And by the way, if everyone, and remember the scripture, you shall truly tithe. If everyone in this church truly tithe, we would have had a building years ago. Seriously, I've done the numbers. But when you're getting 25 here, 50, you guys, that's a McDonald's dinner now. And some, that's our whole tithe for the whole month. It is what it is, right? But we're going to have to answer for that. We'll look at the scripture. Remember what the scripture says? Look at Romans 10:14. How shall they hear without a what? Preacher. So go back. Why are we tithing? So there will be meat in my house. Well, who gives the meat? The preacher. But if he's so busy like in Nehemiah's day doing all the work in the field because he has to eat, right? Then you're not going to have meat in my house. Are you not going to have great music or singing? You know what? There's difference than when you have a soundtrack than with a band. Y'all know that? If you know what? One day, I'll never forget. This just happened not too long ago. A pastor, they said, Pastor, why are we spending all these money on these musicians? So you know what he did? For one Sunday, he said, don't show. It was such a dry, ugly service. People are like, Pastor, sure was dry today. Now you know why we take care of the singers. You hear what I'm saying? Amen. So there will be meat in my house. And it, how much more it could be if we truly tithe. Reason number three, why do we tithe? We're giving you the Bible. The tithe is the inheritance of the Levites, we're told. What's a Levite? A minister. And it's in order for them to do the business of the house of the Lord. It's their inheritance. Look at Numbers 18. Again, for time's sake, I'm going to read it myself. Look at verse 24. It says, I have given to the Levites to inherit, therefore. It's about the tithe. This is their inheritance. Look at verse 25. When you take of that children of the Israelites, which I've given you from them for your inheritance. It's the minister's inheritance. They're not supposed, you're not supposed, if you're bragging because your pastor works two jobs and he also pastors, that says something about you. That's a horrible thing. Being a pastor, I don't want you to boohoo. But it is not easy work. It never ends. That's why 15 years ago, I was going to quit ministry. And my desire, my goal, I wanted to work at Fry's Electronics. My mom goes, why Fry's Electronics? Because you clock in, you clock out. And God says, sorry, Joseph, you're just beginning the fight. You're only 39. I'm 54 now. I'm going to be 55. Because it's hard. It's a hard life. And you shouldn't have to be working all this and then doing this other stuff that you can't. You're going to get what you pay for. Notice, even if you go to verse 31, it says, "For it is your reward for your service in the tabernacle." In other words, the tithe belongs to the minister, but it's really a dual nature because that gives him the ability to do the business of the house of the Lord. What do I mean? Who are the Levites that are supposed to get this? If we go to Nehemiah chapter 10, verse 28, it says, "And the rest of the people, the priests, the Levites, the porters, the singers, the Nephthim, and all them that separate themselves from the people." So we find out that the Levites, we owe the tithe to the Levites. Who are they? Well, we find out they're the priests. Who are the priests? These are the pastoral staff, the preachers, teachers. It says the Levites, these are the sanctuary workers, the musicians, the altar workers, the AV teams. Did you know that all the singers are supposed to be also paid? We don't pay any of our singers. Is it because I don't want to? No, I'm limited in what you give me. So I'm able to do the band to a certain degree, but there's nothing left after that because we got this bill, that bill. So thank God you're wonderful people, but we're still not doing everything we're supposed to be doing, even for these people. Amen. And it pains me. Come on. Thank you. I appreciate that. Did you hear what I just said? We're not really doing what we're supposed to be doing. We're doing the best we can. I can only do so much with a $20 bill or $50. Come on, talk to me. But notice, says the porters. Who are those? The janitors, the security, the singers. Those are the praise and worship teams. This is who's supposed to get a tithe, our portion of it. Nephthim, ministers. These are auxiliary ministries, ministries that you need to help the church go along. All the others separated for the call. You know, we're so blessed. You know how many people donate just to make this thing work? People like Becky Harris, who knows, she's the only one knows what everyone gives. I don't even want to know because I don't want to be upset with people. But she knows. Becky, have I ever paid you for that? You know how much work that is? She should be. And you know what? We'll get there one day. But I even hate saying that. Why aren't we there now? Because it's a matter of tithing. If you think it's not, I mean, there's nothing free in this world. This is the reason why God set this up. And if everybody did like Nehemiah did when he had to rebuke everyone, guess what? Things start to operate. But it has to be between the pastor, the ministers, and the congregation. We have to be one on this. Amen? It also says all those separated for the call. And I want you to notice in Nehemiah 11, verse 22, he says the singers were over the business of the house of the Lord. Nehemiah 11, 16, and they had oversight over the business of the house of the Lord. So even make it more interesting, Nehemiah, not only did he reestablish the tithe, but to make sure the singers never getting their reward, he put some singers over to oversee it, making sure that people got their cut. Come on, talk to me. And I'm going to cut down a holy cow right now. Did you notice this? People always say, church is not a business. Wrong. Over and over, it says they were over the business of the what? House of the Lord. The church is a business. Whether you like it or not, it is a business. In fact, I had to change something on Google the other day. Pastor Bridget did. Someone called like 3 a.m. and they literally were cursing that there wasn't someone able to take that call at 3 a.m. Literally cursing. How dare you? How can you be in ministry? I'm calling, I'm in need. Person don't go to this church. Wasn't even from this state. They got my sister's being abused over there and someone needs to get out of bed over there and go to my sister and go help her. Don't even know the lady. Oh, you see, you think I'm crazy. These are the kind of calls we get as a minister. And you know what she said, where she was right? She says, on Google, it says you're open 24-7. I was like, okay, we're going to change that. So we change it. We're not open 24-7. Come on. But it is a business. When the Lord, when he was 12 years old, he goes to the temple. Come on, go with me. He goes to the temple. And Mary and Joseph lost him. Remember that? And they're looking for 3 days. And he's in the temple hanging out, talking with the Pharisees, the scribes, and breaking down the word with them. Mary comes and says, son, we've been looking for you all these days. And he's like, what? Didn't you know where I'd be? He says, did you not know I'd be at my father's what? Business. Because church is a business. Write this down. What's our business? People. People are our business. And you better run it like a business or else people won't come. We don't just start. Well, we don't know what time we're going to start today. We don't know what time we're going to end. Do you know just to take care of the kids, you have to have business skills. We have to pay people. We have to do that. You know, for the youth that are over there, you know what? I had to buy a building over there. What's over there? When I say buy, lease. Then I had to do this. And there's certain things. I mean, you have to run it like a business or else you wouldn't be able to enjoy the word of God. You don't see people coming every second. Hey, your baby's crying again. Some churches are like that. Come get your child. Not here. Because we run it like a business. We could do even better if we all what? Truly tithe and not tipped. Amen. Amen. Okay. I'm going to wrap this up. I have a lot in there. I do. In relation to the tithe, God gives a really stern warning to those who don't tithe. But again, for time's sake, verse 19, let me read it. Take heed to thyself that thou forsake not the Levite as long as thou liveth upon the earth. God says, as long as you live on the earth, don't forget about the Levite. He's talking about taking care of them. It goes on to say in Malachi 3:9 that if we don't take care of the Levites in our tithes and offering, that we'll be cursed with a curse. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 15 through 66 lists all the curses. You can read it. What is the curse? What is the curse if I don't pay my tithes and offering? There is a curse. And you get all these new, there's no curses in the New Testament. That is not true at all. I've cast out a lot of devils out of people who claim they were saved. That's a curse if you got a devil. So you're talking to the wrong person if you're saying, there's no curses in the New Testament. Oh, yeah, there are. There are curses. That's just someone trying to make you feel good about yourself. If you don't do right, curses do come. Let's go to Malachi chapter 2, verse 2 through 4. I'm going to break this down for you. You're going to understand this really well. Let's hear this.
If you will not hear, and if you will not take it to heart, to give glory to my name, says the Lord of hosts, I will send a curse upon you, and I will curse your blessings.
Yes, I have cursed them already, because you do not take it to heart. Behold, I will rebuke your descendants and spread refuse on your faces, the refuse of your solemn feasts. And one will take you away with it. Then you shall know that I have sent this commandment to you.
That my covenant with Levi may continue, says the Lord of hosts.
I'm going to break this down real shortly, not take too long on this. But it says that your blessings will be cursed if you don't take care of the Levite, if you don't pay your tithe and offerings. And what does that mean, you'll curse my blessings? You have to go to Haggai 1:6 and learn. It's called the hole in the bag curse. Say the hole in the bag curse. That's what will happen if you don't pay your tithes. Let's read it. Ye have sown much and bring in little. Ye eat, but you have not enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe ye, but there's none warm. And he that earneth wages to put it into a bag with holes. God says that if you don't take care of the house of the Lord in your tithes and offering, he says it's gonna be like you have holes in your pockets. When I was 19, I was in ministry, and I was just struggling with never having money, and my grandma never wasted breath. I said, Grandma, I'm working two jobs, and I don't have no money. She says, oh, I can tell you why. I go, oh, really? Well, help me out, okay? She says, because you don't tithe, son. The scripture says when you don't tithe, you'll work and won't have enough. You'll eat and not have enough. You won't have enough clothes to warm you. I said, that's going on. And I'll never forget it hit me. I go, you know what? Because I excuse myself? I was a youth. I was 19. I started tithing. And guess what? I actually got another job that paid less. I don't know how it happened, but I ended up making more money than I did before. And somehow I had enough money. And to this day, I don't understand it. The power of giving. And just test one. Stop not giving. All of a sudden, you'll go, and not one tire, four tires will go out. All of a sudden, you go, and it costs you $900 for a car fix. Come on. All of a sudden, I mean, just all of a sudden, just like holes in your pocket. And that's one of the things that happens. God says, in other words, listen, he's going to get it from you. whether you like it or not. You can either give it freely and get blessed, or you can just let the law of sowing and reaping happen. And by the way, let me break this down for you. God never curses you directly. He never says, you know what? Because you were bad today, I'm going to curse you this day. I'm using an example because I know you won't get upset with me. God doesn't do that. When he says, I will curse you, you have to understand the law of sowing and reaping. In fact, you can read about it in, I believe it's Galatians 6:7. What does that mean? I'm going to curse you. God made all the rules of the universe. If I was to stand on this roof right now and go, I defy the laws of gravity and I'm going to jump, what would happen to me? I'm going to break a leg. Now, did God curse me? No, I broke the rules that he established, yet he did establish the rules of gravity. Understand this. So when you don't pay your tithes and offering, it's not that he directly says, I curse Robert for not tithing. There's rules that he established that if you do them, you'll get blessed. If you don't, a law of nature will come and take it from you. He doesn't directly pick on you. And I'll never forget even when I was going to South Mount Community College, and there was a guy who was over business named Dwayne Brickner. And he was over the whole business school. And man, he wasn't a good man, put it that way. But man, every week I would write a check. And one day I just was noticed that, sir, what are you writing a check? Oh, sending my tithes. I go, you don't go to church. Nope, don't visit church. I go, well, why do you tithe? He says, oh, it's the law of sowing and reaping. And it always amazed me. I've met a lot of people like that who don't go to church, but they have a lot of money because they understand the law of sowing and reaping. Yeah. Notice what else happens. It says, your seed, which is your children, your financial health, it will be reprimanded. Psalm 119:21, thou hast rebuked the proud that are cursed, which do err from thy commandments. It says that dung will be spread. This is horrible language, but it says, literally, you're going to have poo-poo on your face. That if you don't tithe, he says, dung, poo-poo will be on your face. You'll be poo-poo face. In other words, if someone comes in and they got poo-poo all over their face, that's called humility. That's called humiliation. Say humiliating. So what the Bible tells you what the poo-poo on your face is. You want to know what it is? This is crazy. This is really wild. Look, it's Proverbs 21:13. Here's the poo-poo on your face, the humiliation. Whoso stoppeth his ears at the cry of the poor, he also shall cry himself, but shall not be heard. The humiliation, the poo-poo on your face is that God won't hear you because you didn't hear the cry of the Levite. Because you did not hear the cry of the Levite when he said, Lord, where's this? Why am I so poor and I'm working for the Lord? He says, because you didn't hear their cry, I won't hear your cry. You know, going back to the musicians, singers, even crazy Beyonce, I'll call her that, sang in the church. People like Ozzy Osbourne, did you know Pilgrim Brethren, he sang in the church? Elvis Presley sang in the church. The Beatles, John Lennon, Paul McCartney, they played in a youth church before they were famous. We can go on and on. Why is it all these musicians in the world? The church don't pay. People say, why don't we have good church in the music? Well, because we don't pay them. I went to a concert 2 months ago. I was invited. International group, well known all over the world. And I'd heard that the bass player had received Christ. And he hadn't played in a year because he gave his life to Christ and he wanted to just totally dedicate to the Lord. And when we're there at the concert, I looked at my pastoral friend. I go, I thought he wasn't going to play anymore because he got saved and didn't want to play anymore. So we texted him because they were good friends. He texted him. He says, I thought you weren't going to play anymore. And of course, after the concert, because it was a huge concert, he texts us back. He says, I told the Lord I wasn't going to play no more. Or I decided I wasn't because I'm a Christian now. And I was going into church. And every time I go somewhere, they'd hand me a 20, a 50. I have a $1 million home. I can't pay my bills with this. He says, and he was just being honest. He says, so I'm back touring. I'm not drinking, smoking, or doing the girls. He said, I've banned that, but I have to pay my bills. Isn't that just common sense? But it says, because you did not hear the cry of the Levite, In fact, let's look at it. Deuteronomy 24, 14 through 15. Thou shalt not oppress a hired servant that is poor and needy, whether he be of thy brethren or of thy strangers that are in thy land within thy gate. At his day thou shalt give him his hire, neither shall the sun go down upon it, for he is poor, and he setteth his heart upon it. You know God's saying? The Levite, you better pay him when his check comes, because he needs it. His heart's, he can't do without it. He's looking at the sun and waiting for that check to come. Keep going. Lest he cry against thee unto the Lord, and it be sin unto thee. The Lord says, if the Levite cries out and you haven't paid him, or he's wanting God, where are you? He's going to say, that's your sin. I'm going to require it of you. I'm going to end. Now, it seems like this is a rebuke to everybody, and it kind of is. But the next 5 weeks won't be this. We've already covered this part. We're going to get into the law, the spiritual laws that are powerful. I'm going to show you how to be a mover and shaker, right? But this one kind of is, and I just want to tell you, I that's why I've only preached it one time, because it's always this first message where I go, it's rough because you guys are good, but we haven't done everything we need to do here. We're not able to support all the musicians and singers and things. I will continue doing my best. People always ask me, this is being blunt. Pastor, it's 14 years, you still don't get a full-time check. I said, well, if I was to take what I'm required to take, come on, y'all know, what is it called in the Bible? Double honor. That would mean whatever the average is in the congregation, I can get twice as much. I'm allowed to do that. Well, the average person, I think, here makes about 47. That means I can claim about $90,000. I don't. I don't even claim half of that. You know why? There's no way I could pay the band and who we do pay. Does that make sense? There's no way I could. And so I have to go before the Lord and say, Lord, I can't get what I get because there's a lot of people don't even get anything. Does that make sense? But should it be like that? No, because we don't need a bunch of millionaires. We just need everyone to do what you're called to do instead of tipping, you know, oh, Lord, here's $30. No, no. You mean you only made $300 for the whole month? No way. You made like $3,000. You need to pay your $300. You made, you know, whatever it is. Oh, I gave $25. Yeah, but you made $1,500. You should be giving $150. Does that make sense? Okay. I'm going to show you one last rebuke. Take a deep breath. Ready? Go. Because this one's going to hurt. It hurts me. Okay? But I'm going to save you the pain. Like, I'm going to try to make it easy. Rather than hear the whole rebuke from Jesus, Matthew 23, 13 through 33, let's just look at it and kind of point at it. It will help it to be a little bit easier. In Matthew 23, this is my last point. Matthew 23, 13 through 33, Jesus looks at the religious leaders of the day, the Pharisees and the scribes, and he tells you what he thinks of them. In his sermon, it's not that long, is it? Isn't that a short sermon? In that short sermon, he calls the religious leaders, seven times he calls them hypocrites. Three times he calls them blind. Two times he calls them blind guides. Two times he calls them fools. I don't think Jesus was in a hilarious mood during the sermon. I don't picture him smiling like this. Fools, hypocrites, okay? Come on. One time he called them full of dead men's bones. One time he said full of hypocrisy and iniquity. One time he called them children of them which killed the prophets. This is not good. One time he called them serpents, and at the end he called them vipers. How many of you would love this to be your report card from the Lord? Lord, what do you think of me? And he got this loop, full of dead men's bones, you're a viper, you're a serpent. Would that be a good report? No. What's crazy, even though they were bad and Jesus didn't think highly of them, there was one thing that they did that he said, you've done one good thing. Let's look at it. It's actually found in Matthew 23, 23. And he closed it in a rebuke, though. Woe unto you. When the Lord starts with woe, that's not good news. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of the mint and anise and cinnamon. are coming, excuse me, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye have to do, or have done, and not to leave the other undone. So notice what he says. He says, you guys are so religious that even the smallest spice, you tie the tenth. If it's cumin, I said cinnamon, but I meant cumin. Cumin, you'll do it. If it's, what else, an anise, mint, you make sure that you don't miss it. And here's the crazy part. He said, and you should have done that. My problem isn't that. That's the one thing you do right. You're faithful in your tithes. But you forgot about law, judgment, mercy, and faith. He says, you shouldn't have left them out. So out of everything that these people Jesus did not like, he said, there's only one thing where he says, there's only one thing you do right. You tithe right. You take it seriously. You tithe. Even, man, if someone gives you some salt, wait, one-tenth goes to the Lord. He may be at the restaurant. I'm sorry, this goes to the Lord. I'm going to take it to the house of the Lord. In fact, let's look at the witness of a Pharisee, Luke 18:12. Two more scriptures and we're done. This is the words of a Pharisee. He says, I fast twice in the week and I give tithes of all that I possess. Let's say that I give tithes of all that I possess. This is literally a quote from a Pharisee. I give tithes of all that. This is the one thing where God says, you do right. Can you now do some of the other stuff? So it's the only time in the Bible where I can find where Jesus said, you do something right. And it was in their tithing. Take a deep breath. You ready for it? Here it comes. This is the last scripture I'm done. Matthew 5:20. This is where it hurts. The words of Jesus. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. He says, if what you do in righteous, your acts, if you're not better than the Pharisees, you won't go into heaven. Let me say it again. Jesus said, if you're righteous, the things that you do are not better than the Pharisees, you're not making it to heaven. So let me put the two together. If you don't tithe, you are worse than the Pharisee. Because that's the one thing they did right. And he says, your righteousness has to exceed that. That's heavy. Ouch. Are you saying I'm a bad person? No. Read the word of God. You know, he's the one who said, you've robbed me, this whole nation has. And when the Levite cries out, the reason why I don't answer all your prayers is because you won't hear their prayers. You know how long I've been crying out for a building? The Lord hears my prayers. And if I stand before the Lord and that don't happen, it's not going to be my fault. Come on. By the way, we will have it before. I'm not going down like that. But my point is, there comes a time when we have to take this seriously. Because we don't even have to wait for a supernatural blessing. We could actually make some of this come to pass now. We go, you know what? I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do. Yes. Amen? Come on. Whew. Thank you. The next 5 weeks, it won't be like this. You first have to lay the foundation. We won't be talking about your righteousness and the Pharisees, okay? But we do have to take, you know, if you're going to have some dessert, you have to have your meat and your potatoes, right? You can't just eat the ice cream. The ice cream's coming, okay? We're going to get some really good revelation. Because one of the things I'm going to share with you, God literally took me into a vision, and then he showed it to me in the verse. I can't wait to get that to you. And it happened to be with the prophetic word. Why I'm teaching this is that there's some things about to be happening. You've heard me prophesy. And we're not talking years from now. We're talking maybe weeks. And so I want to teach you these principles so that you can prosper even at a time when it's hurting out there. And we're coming to the point where if you're not tithing, you're going to pay for it, right? I want to cover you supernaturally because he says, test me if I will not rebuke the devourer, right? He says, test me if I won't protect you. What am I trying to say? There's a storm coming. There's a reason why I'm teaching this right now. because I want to make sure you're protected. Because there's some things I can't do for you, your boss can't do for you, but God can just supernaturally, boom, come on, right? My wife told me something. She said, Joseph, if you're going to teach this again, then you're obligated to teach some of the practical aspects of this. And she's right. There's a practical side to finances. Why do people don't tithe? Is because we never learned how to budget in school. Your boss don't teach you how to budget. Most people never had a father that sat down and taught them the budget. We're just making it the best we can. That's why in 2016, when I did this series, I also did a financial series called The Money Game. We did it on Wednesday night, and I charged people $150 to attend that. And I did 6 weeks of teaching on the practical side. I was mentored by two millionaires, and I literally gave you the outline. Powerful. I'm not going to do that this time, but because my wife said you're obligated to teach some practical side, I'm going to donate one Sunday from this course that you usually pay a few hundred dollars, and we're going to do the first day, Introduction to Budget, Interest, and Taxes. Why? Because how are you going to pay your tithes if you don't even understand budget? And just what you learn in this one class, this right here, you could literally learn to make $800 to $1,000 more per month just from this lesson alone. What? This is why people pay for it. So what I want to do is, I don't know what Sunday it is, but I want to know if there's an interest. If there's not at least 15 people, my time's worth more than that. If there's enough people, go ahead and pick up your phone, hit the QR code or text budget and say, I'm interested. If you are, we'll name the date. And I'm going to teach the first section for free because I'm obligated. My wife says I'm obligated to. And she's right. We'll teach this. That alone, by the way, is powerful. It is really powerful. And then if we're there and people go, Pastor, I want all of it. Okay, well, maybe then we'll do the whole seminar. But for now, I'm only going to do one of the six. The first, it's the foundation, but it teaches you on budget, interest. No one's going to tell you this stuff. You'll be blown away just by this and this. I'll actually show you. How many just had a child born? Anybody? Or do you know someone has a child born? Anybody? None of you have people that know people were born? Okay, a few of you. You're asking me, why am I saying that? Because it's really, really good if they're newborn. We can show you a way where for $15 a month, by that time that child's 60, they can be a millionaire. And you're only giving $15 a month for like 20 years. That's not bad, is it? Well, what about older people? You can, but then you have to do more. You have to come to understand this. But this is why this is important, because if you have someone just was born, what a great gift, $15 a month. And there's things you can do that no one will tell you. But we'll share some of these things. Very powerful stuff. Were y'all able to get the QR code? You just take a picture or you text? Okay. Let's stand in the house of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Isn't he good? Amen. Come on, give the Lord. I just want to reiterate, this is not a message to make you feel bad. It is a message to make you repent, though, if you're not doing right. But the reason is not just to get more money. The reason is to put you in a position to experience supernatural prosperity. You're saying, what do you mean? Let me give you one last example. Just the other week, somebody in here, they run a club for basketball for boys. And they pay their tithes and their offering, but they were having a hard time getting people to sponsor for their costumes, their shirts. You know, that costs a lot of money. And the person said, you know what? I'm going to do what Pastor said. I'm going to give. So they gave an offering for that in the mind. Did you know the moment they walked to church, within 1 hour, someone called and said, by the way, I don't know why, but I feel like I need to sponsor your team. Sponsor the whole team. That was just a week ago. Because they heard him talk about the power of giving. And they couldn't find no one. And they walk out an hour later in church. and the person doesn't know, just, I feel like I'm supposed to, oh, yes, please. And bought them all the shirts. They got everything they needed. Come, thank you, Pastor. No, thank the Lord. That's why we're doing this. Showing you, what do you do when every door's shut? What do you do when I can't work any more hours? There's a way you can reap supernaturally. But it's not enough just to give your tithe. You also have to proclaim it. Lord, this is what I want. Does that make sense? Like, you put an assignment to that thing. That's why every week when you come in here, we talk about jobs and better jobs. But is it right? Because I'm trying to teach you that when you tithe, claim something out of that. So we do it without saying it, but we do it every week.